Detroit. Put those hands together all over this place. We come to praise him, we come to praise him and lift him up because he's worthy to be praised.
Sing. The Spirit of the Lord comes upon my heart. This is the new Peloton tread.
Let's go, Peloton!
Now you can step on for miles.
Pick those knees up! Am I in Dallas? Keep it up!
And jump off for so much more.
Let's go ahead and grab those weights.
With strength.
Keep that core nice and tight.
Boot camp.
Looking strong! Don't stop, don't quit.
And yoga.
Stay with me.
That's right, that's right. Put those hands together all over this place. We come to praise him, we come to praise him, and lift him up because he's worthy to be praised.
Do, but I'm gonna dance, 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 made the Lord.
Sorry, I wasn't talking directly into it. Good morning. How do we celebrate great events in our lives? Celebration for the Lord can be as diverse as the people who engage in it. King David expressed his joy in celebration of God by leading God's people in music, offerings, and in jubilant dance. Good morning, CFL. My name is Brother Harold Hayes, and I'm glad to be here with you this morning, this wonderful overcast Sunday morning. I thank the Lord for this day that we have before us, and I thank him for this lesson that we have before us also. Once again, it is my honor and a privilege to come before you to deliver the Sunday school lesson this morning. Today we find the title of this lesson is David Danced Before the King. And our background scripture is in 2 Samuel 6, verses 1 through 5, and then we'll be jumping over to verses 14 through 19. And the devotional reading is in Ecclesiastes 3, 1 and 9. So as I said before, the unifying principle is celebrating with enthusiasm. With enthusiasm. So as we always do, I would like to start off with prayer today. Heavenly Father, thank you for this fantastic day, Lord God. Thank you for everything that we have, everything that you have given us, and everything that will come to us in the future, Lord God. We thank you for good times, and we thank you for the bad, because all of them are a reason why we should celebrate and to worship you, Lord God. We thank you for this lesson today. I ask as the facilitator that you use my mouth and my heart and move my personality aside so that you can speak to those ears that are within ears, those ears that are listening this morning, Lord God, so they may hear the lesson that you have before them about worshiping you openly and outwardly and with joy. And all these things I ask and pray in your wonderful, magnificent name. Amen. So let's get, without further ado, let's get started. As I said before, we are in 2 Samuel 6, 1 through 15, and then we're going to be skipping over to verses 14 through 19. So let me give you a little bit of background. So the people, places, and events. We are talking about the Ark of the Covenant, the Ark of God. Now, the Ark's journey during the wilderness wanderings, the Ark was kept in the tabernacle whenever the camp moved. But once the Israelites were established in the Promised Land, the Ark and entire tabernacle complex were kept in Bethel. Now that's in Judges 20:27. At one point during Samuel's time as judge, Israel's army got into a battle, as they did many times, with the Philistines. The Philistines won this battle and captured the Ark in 1 Samuel 4. So God sent signs and sickness on the Philistines until they returned the sacred object to Israel at Bethshemoth. Now, God also struck down 70 men in Bethshemoth just for trying to look inside the ark. The people there called for the priests of Kiriath Jearim to retrieve the ark. No attempt was made to return it to the tabernacle, and it remained in that location for 20 years. So in the background, so we have David. David is the center point of this week's lesson. So he's David, the giant slayer, the musician, the conqueror, the king. How did David, Jesse's baby boy, a young shepherd, ascend to the throne of Israel? So David, the king, who united Israel and Judah, was not born into royalty. Of his father Jesse's eight sons, David was the youngest, and in the book of Samuel, David is found in the fields by the prophet Samuel after God guides him to the young shepherd. Now, David gains fame first as a musician and later by killing the giant Goliath, champion of the Philistines. He becomes a favorite of King Saul, and both Israel and Judah loved him. And he was also a close friend and besties with Saul's son, Jonathan. Now, after killing Goliath, Saul makes him general over his armies and gives him 1,000 men to command. Now, worried that David is trying to take his throne, Saul turns on him and tries to have him killed, leading the latter to go into or go on the run and to operate as a fugitive for several years. So after Saul and Jonathan were killed in another battle against the Philistines, the 30-year-old David was anointed king over all Israel by the elders in the south. He then conquers Jerusalem, establishing the city as his capital. Now he turns his attention to relocating the Ark of the Covenant back to the city to be the center of worship in the Israelite region. So David, who entered life as a humble shepherd, rose to establish a dynasty, and in the process became a central figure in Judaism, Christianity, and in Islam. It is significant that one of David's top priorities was related to Israel's spiritual life. David consulted with his officials, and his proposal to move the ark was met with enthusiastic agreement. The ark had been in Bala of Judah, also called Kiriath Jearim, according to 1 Chronicles 13, 1 through 8. Before David could execute his plan, he was delayed by two unsuccessful Philistine attacks. He captured the city of Jerusalem, as I said before, and set up a government there. He even renamed the city of David. Once established, David turned his attention back to the relocation of the ark. And that brings us to this week's scripture. I'll be reading back and forth, as I usually do, between the New Living Translation and the King James Translation. So we're starting off in 2 Samuel 6 and 1. And the word of God said, "Then David again gathered all the elite troops in Israel, 30,000 in all." So he didn't get farmers and common folk. He got some of the most elite troops, the most fit young men, warriors. Verse 2, he led them to Bala of Judah to bring back the Ark of God, which bears the name of the Lord of Heaven's armies, who is enthroned between the cherubim. The cherubim are the angels on the top of the ark. Their wings are outstretched toward each other. And there within the gap is where Moses heard the voice of God. So they placed the Ark of God on a new cart and brought it from Abinadab's house, which was on a hill. Uzzah and Ahio, Abinadab's sons, were guiding the cart. In verse 4, they carried the ark of God. Ahio walked in front of the ark. David and all the people of Israel were celebrating before the Lord, singing songs and playing all kinds of music, musical instruments, lyres, harps, tambourines, castanets, and cymbals. So in the first part of the scripture here, verses 1 through 5, we see the significance of the extracting of the ark. So what does the Ark of the Covenant actually symbolize? It actually symbolizes God's presence and was the holiest of the items in the tabernacle. At one point, the ark had been captured by the Philistines in battle, but God was displeased and caused them all types of chaos for them. So let's talk about the ark for just a second. Okay. So the ark of God, King David resolved to move the Ark of the Covenant into Jerusalem, the capital city. The king desired for the congregation to experience God's presence. David sought to show his recognition to Jehovah, and on behalf of the Israelite nation, David danced with high energy and exuberance as the priest carried the ark into Jerusalem. Now, the ark was a rectangular wooden box overlaid with gold, measuring about 3 feet long and about 2 feet wide. Inside the ark, the contents were the Ten Commandments, Aaron's rod, a jar of manna, and the mercy seat, which is the lid on it, the mercy seat with the blood of a sacrificial lamb sprinkled on it once per year. So the high priest is the one that actually did that. The Ark of the Covenant symbolized God's presence, his glory, and throne. That's in Psalm 88, 1
and 99:1. The presence of the ark also fulfilled the Father's desire to dwell among his people. So, as we see here, David is trying to get the ark back to his people. And everyone is exuberant and actually very thrilled about it getting back to the tabernacle. So David amassed 30,000 troops, and by a large number of Israelites who wanted to be included in the procession itself. This was an occasion for the great celebration for the people of Israel. So the reason that he got this together and had so many troops come at one point in time was because he understood that their arch enemy was the Philistines. So the extraction of the ark from Kerith required extensive planning. So David selected a large force of 30,000 men. Remember, when the ark was actually taken before, there were approximately 30,000 Israelites that were killed in the battle, the previous battle with the Philistines. There were many battles with the Philistines. They were like the Hatfields and the McCoys. They could not stand each other. So he got these men together in case they were attacked by the Philistines while they were trying to relocate it back to Jerusalem. So just the thought of regaining the ark was a jubilant, wonderful occasion for the children of Israel. So they had a new cart to transport the ark. The sons of Abinadab were selected to guide the cart that would transport the sacred ark back to Jerusalem. This is in 1 Samuel 7 and 1. They were singing and the music of various instruments and playing the music of various instruments as they prepared for the successful moving of the ark. It is easy to get swept up in all the pomp and celebration. However, even though the Israelites wanted to do a good thing, they had not discussed the matter with God. And the question that I have is this: what can we modern saints learn from this portion of the lesson? And I think what we can learn is that planning and preparation, no matter how much the great intentions are, without consulting God first, is merely a waste of time. So we'll move on now to verses 14 and 15. And David danced before the Lord with all his might, wearing a priestly garment. Now, this is strange because David is a king. He's not a priest, but he's wearing an ephod, which the scriptures will actually get into in a little while. So David and all the people of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord with shouts of joy and the blowing of ram's horns. So ram's horns, in modern terms, those would be interpreted as trumpets. But as the ark of the Lord entered the city of David, Michal, the daughter of Saul, looked down from her window. When she saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord, she was filled with contempt for him. And in verse 17, they brought the ark of the Lord and set it in its place inside the special tent David had prepared for it. And David sacrificed burnt offerings and peace offerings to the Lord. Verse 18, when he had finished his sacrifices, David blessed the people in the name of the Lord of heaven's armies. And to conclude in verse 19, then he gave every Israelite man and woman in the crowd a loaf of bread, a cake of dates, and a cake of raisins. Excuse me. Then all of the people returned to their homes. So we see what's going on here is that as they brought the ark in, this was not the first time that they brought the ark in. This was actually the second time they brought the ark in. Even though they had gotten together and gotten a new ox cart to put the Ark of the Covenant on, they had the best intentions, but that's not how God wanted things done. That's just not how he wanted them done. So what lesson do we have to learn from this? It's that even though we may have the best intentions, if you don't consult the Lord first, then nothing good is going to come of it. Sure, there may not be calamity, there may not be chaos, but there definitely won't be blessing because you're not working within the will of God. You're outside of the will of God, and you're working on your will. In other words, we hold events at the church, and we do things, and we have people that are in charge. Sometimes we have personalities that bump up against each other, and people get upset with each other and don't talk for years and stuff like that because someone is questioning the way that someone else is doing something. But what we all need to do is be on one accord. As the body of Christ, we need to be following the word of God. We need to understand what it is that he has for us to do and then follow what he has for us to do to the letter. So that means in order to listen to what he has to do and to follow what he has to do, you first have to consult the Lord. This is what they did not do. So the second time around, David was a little afraid because a lot of drama had happened when it came to the ark. So he was a little fearful when it came down to moving it. So in verses 6 through 13, which are not in this week's lesson, it actually describes the tragic death of one of the Israelites in the first attempt to bring the ark back to Jerusalem. Earlier, when the ark was in the field of Joshua, the men of Beth-Shemeth became curious and attempted to take a peek inside the ark. God struck 70 of the men dead instantly. While not the focus of this particular week's lesson, this knowledge gives crucial insight to the remaining verses. By this time, David was fearful of making a second attempt to bring the ark to Jerusalem 3 months later. So now we're going to verses 14 and 15. So if there's one thing we learned, it's that the people of Israel did not dwell on their past mistakes. So they get up and keep on pushing forward. In these 3 months that passed, David learned that the placing of the ark on an ox cart, even if it was new, was forbidden. Sometimes we can have the best intentions, but when we act without consulting God first, we are like children near a hot stove. Something bad can definitely happen. So in Numbers 7:9, it tells us that the ark and all other sacred items were to be carried on the shoulders of the Levite priests. And even they had to use specially made poles to keep from touching the ark. Now, armed with the Lord's instructions, David made a second attempt to move the ark. So again, he did so with a great celebration. David wore a priestly garment called an ephod and danced before the Lord with all his might. As the instruments played, the people of Israel followed their king's lead, shouting for joy and offering sacrifices. When has taking time to consult the Lord changed your plans for the better? I know that when I take the time to consult the Lord, I know that I have a peace of mind going into an event or going into a decision making that I wouldn't normally have just by doing things myself. The peace of mind that I get is from consulting the Lord. And we can understand too that when we go into that and we make decisions and we consult the Lord, he will give us that peace of mind. Even when he doesn't give us the result that we necessarily wanted, he will always give us what we needed. Okay, so as we get down to verses 14, excuse me, let me go back over and read them real quick. Now, this time I'm reading from the NIV version, so I'm just going to read those real fast. 14 through 19, wearing a linen ephod, David was dancing before the Lord and with all his might, while he and all Israel were bringing up the ark of the Lord with shouts and the sounds of trumpet. As the ark of the Lord was entering the city of David, Michal, daughter of Saul, watched from a window. Now, I need to stop here for a second. So as David entered Jerusalem, his wife Michal looked down on his jubilant dance in disgust. Unlike David, she was born and raised in royalty, so she came from aristocracy. Her sense of hierarchy was ingrained in who she was at her core. Now, after his victory over the Philistines, Saul offered his eldest daughter, Merab, to David, but David refused politely. Then Saul learned that his youngest daughter, Michal, was in love with David, so he offered her to him. At first, David declined again, stating that he was a poor man and couldn't afford a bride's ransom. Now, Saul waived the price in exchange for the foreskins of 100 Philistines. Now, David took the challenge at heart instead of killing, because you had to kill a man to get his foreskin. So instead of killing 100 Philistines, David killed 200, paying for the bride's price twice over. Now, David calculated that he could cement his place in the royal circle by doing so. It worked for a while, because Michal was dedicated to her husband and his safety. When Saul turned on him and sent his guards to arrest him, it was Michal who lied and said he was sick in bed and to come back later. She didn't know that, I mean, she knew that they were coming to arrest David, but she said, come back a little bit later, as if she didn't know. And if that wasn't bad enough, minutes later, she risked her own life when she helped David escape by using linens to lower him from their bedroom window. After his general fled, Saul married Michal off to another man, and David, in typical David form, married several other wives. Later, after Saul died in battle, David became king of Judah, and Saul's only surviving son, Ishbel, assumed the throne as king of Israel. Now, David demanded Michal be returned as his wife, but unfortunately, her love for him had cooled in their second marriage. Now, verse 14, it tells that David danced before the ark with all of his might, which is fantastic. That is a symbol for us. We should all worship the Lord with all of our might and become unrestrained in our love for him and praising him. In verse 15, it tells us that everyone, it was contagious, was following along the ark, shouting and playing trumpets. In verse 16, when David entered the city, however, his wife, Michal, which is said before, the daughter of Saul, watching him from a palace window. Now, picture this if you can. Watching someone from a palace window. It was high up. Think of our balcony and looking down from our balcony. So how often do we as Christians find ourselves looking down upon other saints? Not with love, but with judgment. So, and when she saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord, she despised him in her heart. Now, the word despise means to hold in contempt, in disdain, to disrespect even. So why do we have to guard our hearts? In this particular situation, Michal's heart had changed for David. She went from adoring him and saving him to judging him and feeling disgust for him. So she wasn't guarding her heart. Why do we have to guard our hearts? Well, I'm glad you asked. Guarding our hearts means protecting ourselves as Christians from all the things that we could that would come to harm us. We have to overcome temptations every single day. We need to find ways to overcome doubts and that tend to creep up on us. We guard our hearts against all kinds of distractions from our faith. Jesus even said, "They honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me," in Matthew 15:8. So in contrast, we see what's going on here. When Saul gave Michal to David, she adored him in 1 Samuel 18 and 20. But the very next verse, it reveals what his intentions were. Now she despises him. In 1 Samuel 18 and 21, the very next verse, we find that Saul gave her to David, but he did so that she could be a snare to him for the Philistines. So I explained something to you. My grandmother was old school. She prayed every day, and when the situation warranted it, she even went to her prayer room, her closet, and prayed. I pray, but when it's serious, I know that I fall upon my knees. These are two totally different ways. The point here is not to judge someone for how they praise and worship the Lord. The point is to join them, not judge them, in their praise and worship of the Lord. So, So we see that David is wearing the ephod. Now the ephod is a sleeveless garment worn by the Jewish priest, the Levite priest. I don't know, the word doesn't exactly explain why David had gone from his kingly wardrobe to a priestly wardrobe, because he was not a priest. So Michael looked down on David literally as well as figuratively. So we have to understand that she came from aristocracy, so she probably looked at him saying, "You're not acting like a king. You're acting like a fool. And as the king, you're above the people. Don't dance in the streets like a fool." So she looked down on him in a negative way, and he was merely worshiping God in an unbridled manner. So the good thing about this is we see so many things here that are happening. So David and Michael are in dissension with each other because David is praising God and Michael doesn't agree with it. He says, and in verse 17 it says, "They brought the ark of the Lord and set it in its place inside the tent that David had pitched for it. So David sacrificed burnt offerings and fellow offerings before the Lord." So I want to take a moment to explain the difference between burnt offerings and fellowship offerings. Burnt offerings in 2 Samuel 6:17, what we're talking about, were one of several major sacrifices described in the Old Testament. The main passages are Leviticus 1, 6, and that's 8 through 13, and 22, 8 through 20, and Numbers 15, 1 through 16. This was a kind of sacrifice in which the acceptable parts of the animal being offered were completely burnt. When properly done, nothing remained from the sacrifice, whether for the layperson offering it or the priest who officiated the ritual. This procedure involved the layperson bringing the animal, whether it be a bull, a sheep, a goat, or a bird, to be sacrificed and placing his hand on the head of the animal. In this way, the creature became an acceptable substitute to make atonement for the offer. Then this person slaughtered the animal, followed by a priest splashing the blood of the victim across against all sides of the altar at the tabernacle entrance. Next, the animal was skinned, cut into sections, and placed on the altar. Both the inner organs and the lower legs of the victim of the sacrifice were washed The sacrifice were washed with water. After that, the entire carcass was burnt on the altar with fire. The purpose was to express total devotion and dedication to the Lord, along with making reconciliation for the layperson's sins. So we see that type of burnt offering. Now, when it comes to a peace offering, peace offerings also in 2 Samuel 17 are also referred to as fellowship offerings in the NIV. The main Old Testament passages where pertinent information are in Leviticus. So the sacrificial animal, which could be either a male or a female, lamb, sheep, or goat, had to be without blemish. We see this over and over again, to this pattern of being without blemish. When Jesus was about to go into Jerusalem, he sent two of his disciples to the town, the next town over, to get a donkey that was without blemish. They called it a colt who had never been ridden before. And they went and got that because that has to be that way, because God does not take anything that is blemished, anything that is used. So we see here that the pattern of coming before God in an unblemished way, in an undirty way, as not to defile ourselves before the Lord. Because as we know, the Lord doesn't do anything willy-nilly. He does things in a certain order, in a certain way. And we cannot change that way. We cannot adapt. We cannot alter that way. We can simply follow that way. So in the peace offering, the ritual involved the layperson placing his hand on the head of the offering and then slaughtering it at the outer court of the tabernacle entrance. Then a priest splashed the animal's blood against all sides of the altar. Next, various portions of the inside of the carcass, including the fat and the kidneys, were completely burnt on the altar. None of its fat and blood were to be consumed. This offering included a communal meal. in which the layperson, his family, and the officiating priest join in eating the meat of the sacrificial animal, that is, except for the portions allotted to the rest of the priests. The purpose of the offering was to express the layperson's desire to enjoy harmony between himself and God, and it also included a desire for a peaceful relationship with one's Israelite peers. Now, there was a need for that, and it was because the Israelites had a lot of enemies at that time, as we say in this particular lesson, especially the Philistines. Now, but I want to explain something to you, the difference between the sacrifices of the Old Testament and the sacrifices of the New. So when it came to a blood sacrifice, from at least the time Abel offered the firstborn from his flock to the Lord in Genesis 4, people have shed the blood of an animal as an act of sacrifice to God. Indeed, this ritual pervades the Old Testament, in which blood sacrifice was considered to be atonement for sin. In a sense, then, the sacrificial animal became a substitute ransom for the sinner itself. Now, these ceremonies, however, were not completely effective. The New Testament reveals that true and lasting atonement could only occur through the blood shed by Jesus Christ. As the Lamb of God, he died on our behalf to cleanse us from our sins once and for all. Now, I say the words once and for all, and let me explain to you. The top of the Ark of the Covenant was laid in gold, and it had two cherubims on it, which are angels, and their wings were outstretched to each other, but they weren't touching. There was a small gap in between them. And this is where the Spirit of God was. It is said that Moses even heard the voice of God between the wingtips of the cherubim. Now you have to understand, the top of the Ark of the Covenant was called the mercy seat. It was the top of the Ark, and it covered the Ark. Jesus is also called the mercy seat because he covers our sins with his blood. So I want to read something to you that's really interesting that I came about during my studies. So the mercy seat was the closure or the covering of the holy box called the Ark of the Covenant. It housed, among other things, the stone tablets inscribed with the Ten Commandments. Though the mercy seat served as a type of lid in terms of the Ark of the Covenant, to better comprehend the purpose, the mercy seat, the words covering and shield are more acceptable. So keep those in mind, covering and shield. The tablets with the Ten Commandments stored underneath bore witness to the sin of the people. Above, or rather on the mercy seat, the blood of sacrifice was sprinkled by the high priest for the atonement for sin. This is why emphasis is placed on the word covering, okay? Covering, because the mercy seat is the place of transference of sin for forgiveness, of reconciliation between God and his people. Joseph Prince puts it this way: as long as the blood was there on the mercy seat, he, God, saw only the blood and accepted the people. So we understand that it's the same way. Jesus' blood, unlike the sacrificial blood in the Old Testament, Jesus' blood is a covering for our sins. It keeps us safe. Without it, there is no redemption. Without it, there is no salvation. So we have to understand, even though we don't sacrifice lambs and different animals nowadays, we understand that we are covered, as I said before, and shielded by the blood of Jesus Christ. So in this particular lesson, when it talks about the Ark and all of its travels and how it came back to Jerusalem, but it came back not the wrong way, it came back the right way. Because all of those people who had held the Ark for certain periods of time and kept it away from Israel, every single one of them came calamity. Even Abinadab's sons, Uzzah and Ahiah, they even had a little bit of calamity as well. Well, I can't call a little bit of calamity. As they were carrying it along in the cart, it stumbled and the Ark almost fell, and Ahio went to grab it, to keep it from falling. And the minute that he grabbed it and touched the ark, God struck him dead because they weren't doing it the right way. So when they started doing it the right way is when the Levite priests actually used the poles and slid them through the holes and actually carried the ark upon their shoulders. And this was even so that the Levite priests wouldn't even touch the ark. They were the right ones to carry it. The poles were the right way to carry it. Even though it was a new ox cart that David had brought, it wasn't the way that God wanted it to be transported. So it was corrected, and then it was done the right way. So we need to understand that when we have the word, it is there for correction. And it's not anything personal against us. Because God loves us, he chastises us. We use the word to correct our behavior and to inspire us so that we can have understanding. And then with our understanding, we can gain wisdom. So in this particular situation, David is celebrating like you would not believe. Now, was David a flawed man? Of course he was. But then again, if you start to study, it won't be long before you realize that God used flawed people all the time. Noah was flawed. David was flawed. Moses was flawed. And still, God used them for his greater good and for his will. So in conclusion, we need to understand that worshiping God can come in many different forms. But one thing is common. It always involves refocusing our thoughts away from our daily lives and on and adoring God for who he is and what he continues to do for us. Let me say that one more time. It always involves refocusing our thoughts away from our daily lives and on an adoring God for who he is and what he continues to do for me. There's a song that I love to hear, and it says, he keeps doing great things for me. If I had 10,000 tongues, I'd praise him with every one. So we need to understand we can praise God in whatever way that we want to, as long as our heart is in tune with his will, because he adores us and because he loves us. So as long as the blood was on the mercy seat, he, God, saw only the blood and accepted us. So it is just right for us to praise and worship him with our mouths, with our lives, with our bodies as a testament, with our time, our energy, our finances. It's all right to praise God and to praise him openly, because what you're doing is just showing love for a God that first loved you. Amen. Heavenly Father, thank you for this lesson today, Lord God. Thank you for taking us to 2 Samuel and thank you for showing us that it's all right to do things in worship of our Lord and Savior. Thank you for showing us that even though we may have the best intentions, we should always consult our Father first before we take action. That way we don't waste our time and our energy and our resources. And Lord God, thank you for the lesson of letting us know that even though we may adore you and worship you in our way, there are others that may judge us for doing it. Lord God, I ask that you touch our hearts, which is where disgust comes from, Lord God. And I ask that you stop us, humble us, help us to turn from our evil ways, Lord God, so that we can accept others as they praise and worship you, Lord God. And as we come along this lesson, as it saturates within our spirit during this week, if it be your will, Lord God, have us share it with someone else as we cross paths with them. And let them understand that you are a merciful God. You love to give mercy. And we thank you for that, Lord God. We thank you for your wonderfulness. We thank you for who you are. We thank you for what you've done for us, even when we didn't know you were doing it, Lord. We thank you for what you do for us now, and we thank you for what you will do for us in the future, Lord God. And all these things we ask and pray in your wonderful, magnificent, holy name. Amen.
That's right, that's right. Put those hands together all over this place. We come to praise him, we come to praise him, and lift him up because he's worthy to be praised.
Spirit of the Lord comes upon my heart. I will dance like David danced. When the Spirit of the Lord comes upon my heart, I will dance like David danced. I will dance,
The Spirit of the Lord comes upon my heart. sing like David sang.
Say bless, say
bless.
Yeah!
Tonight, heart.
That are going through. For those of us that are waiting on his promise, understand God has not forgotten you. When times get tough, you got to look up to heaven and encourage yourself and say,
Please stand. The Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him. Please be seated.
Good morning, my brothers and sisters. Welcome. Welcome to this morning praise and worship service. May the peace of the Lord be with you. Yes. How about giving the Lord a big round of applause as he woke us up this morning? He sent us on our way. He never leave us and forsake us. Glory to his holy name. This morning I will be opening devotion with scripture and a prayer. May we stand for this morning's scripture reading. I will be reading from the book of 2 Chronicles in the Old Testament. Book of 2 Chronicles, chapter 20, verses 12 through 18. Second Chronicles, chapter 20, verses 12 through 18. And the reading of the mighty word of the Lord is as follows. Our God, without, not judge them. For we have no might against the great company that cometh against us. Neither now we what to do, but our eyes are upon thee. And all Judah stood before the Lord with their little ones, their wives, and their children. Then upon Jehaziel, the son of Zechariah, and Benaiah, the son of Jehiel, the son of Mattaniah, a Levite, and the sons of Asaph, came the Spirit of the Lord in the midst of the congregation. Yeah. And he said, hearken ye, all Judah and your inhabitants of Jerusalem and thou King Josaphat, thus saith the Lord unto you, be not afraid or dismayed by reason of this great multitude, for the battle is not yours, but God's. Amen. To the marrow go ye down against them. Behold, they come up by the cliff of Ziz, and ye shall find them at the end of the brook before the wilderness of Yarul. Ye should not need to fight in this battle. Yeah. Set yourselves, stand ye still, and see the salvation of the Lord with you, O Judah and Jerusalem. Fear not, nor be dismayed to mar out against them, for the Lord will be with you. And Josaphat bowed his head with his face to the ground, and all Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem fell before the Lord, worshiping the Lord. I've read to you from the mighty book of 2 Chronicles, chapter 20, verses 12 through 18. May the Lord have a blessing through the reading of his holy word.
Good morning, Christian Fellowship. How y'all doing this morning?
Sure.
Amen. This simple song is called, Oh, Give Thanks, all right? Oh, give thanks.
Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good.
Yes, he is.
Yes, he is good.
Oh, give thanks.
Oh, give thanks
unto the Lord.
Unto the Lord, for he is good.
For he is.
Yes, he is good.
Oh, give thanks.
Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Yes, he is good. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Yes, he,
yes, he is good.
Yes, he is worthy. 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 Good.
Yes,
yes, he is good.
Bow our heads for a word of prayer. To the Holy Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost. O Lord, excellent is thy name. Your mercy and grace endureth forever. O Lord, we come on this day not for what you've done for us, O Lord, but for who you are. Oh, you are our leader. You are our master, our provider, our protector. You are our all in all. We come to give you honor. We come to give you glory. Lord, we ask that you have your way in this service today, Lord. Oh, Lord, people are hurting today, hurting like they've never been before. We ask that you just touch us, Lord, down in our souls, Lord. Touch us, Lord. Lead us, guide us, strengthen us with endurance. With endurance, let us be encouraged. Oh, Lord, we ask for blessing and healing today. Lord, we ask that you bless, heal, and strengthen the shepherd of this church. Strengthen him and his family, Lord. Keep him guided and directly on your will as we shall follow. Oh, Lord, we thank you for each and every one that is here today. We ask you that you bless them, Lord, in a very special way. Lord, we ask that you keep us close and near you. With all what's going on around the world, Lord, we need you. We need you. Step in, show up, and show out in our lives. You are the reigning king. You are the king of kings. And we love you. Because you first love us. Oh Lord, we ask that you strengthen and heal those that are sick, shut in, spiritually defeated. Let them know that there is hope. that you are the light and you are the way. Oh, Lord, keep us on that narrow path toward you this day. Oh, Lord, we love you. We love you. Guide and direct us. Heal and strengthen the sick, the shut-in, those that are in hospital, those that are in hospice, those that are just struggling emotionally, physically. Oh, Lord, lay your hands on them. Oh, Lord, tell them to keep the faith. Because we praise and worship you in spirit and in truth. Oh, Lord, there's no one like you. There's no one like you. When we walked away from you, Lord, you turned us back around toward you. Hallelujah to your precious name. Oh, Lord, thank you. Thank you. Lord, we ask you to look out for the poor, the sick, the shut-in, our young people. Oh, Lord, with all this bigotry and hatred, Lord, we all may be different colors and shades, but we on the inside, you cut us open, we bleed red. Oh, and that's your precious blood. Thank you for Calvary. Have your way in this service today, Lord. We lift you up. We give you honor. We give you glory. And it's in your name we say amen. This will conclude our devotional portion of service. The duration of service will be from the pulpit.
Good morning, Christian Fellowship.
Morning.
Good morning. For you are you.
You deserve the glory.
And the honor. I lift my hands in worship. And I bless your holy name. You deserve the glory.
Hallelujah.
And the honor. I lift my hands in worship. And I bless your holy name.
Say with me.
You deserve the glory.
I praise
your
for you are great.
Holy name, for you are great.
You do miracles.
You do miracles so great.
There is no one else.
There is no one else like you.
There is no one else like you.
There is no one else like you.
You are great. Nobody like you.
Like you.
You're Alpha and Omega.
Like you.
You're the beginning and the end.
Like you.
Last time like you.
Like you.
Belongs to you. y'all help me sing that.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Anybody out there want to testify that? My hallelujah.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
My hallelujah.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
For one reason, because you deserve it.
You deserve it.
Hallelujah, you deserve it.
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 All of the glory. All of the glory belongs to you.
All of the glory, all of our honor, all of our praise, all of the glory.
All of the glory belongs to you. All of the glory belongs to you.
All of the glory belongs to you.
All of the glory belongs to you.
'Cause you deserve it.
You deserve it.
'Cause you deserve it.
You deserve it.
All of our praise, you deserve it. Because I sin and you still love me, you deserve it. Because in my well-doing you still bless me, you deserve it. Because when I feel sick you still let me know
you deserve it.
When finances are right, God, you still make a way,
you deserve it.
So Lord, we praise you, you deserve it.
You deserve it.
I'll sing that one time.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Hallelujah. My hallelujah belongs.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
One more time, just because I feel his spirit. My hallelujah.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Last time, my hallelujah.
My hallelujah belongs to you.
Amen, amen. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise, for he is worthy to be praised. He is worthy of our praise each and every day. As I stand here, I would like for you all to pray with me as we invite the Lord into this service, which he is already here, but we just want to acknowledge his presence. Almighty God, we are in awe of your magnificent power displayed through the entire universe. For those you all things, though for through you all things were made, and all things have their being. We come before you with grateful thanks and with hearts that long to adore you and worship only you, Heavenly Father. Lord, may we know the presence of the Holy Spirit here with us today. May we be open to your leading, sensitive to your speaking, and alert to your calling. Father, we invite the same power that was at work when Jesus was raised from the dead to be present with us here now. Lord, we declare that you are welcome here among us all. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
I'm seeing some faces I haven't seen for a while. For the last year and a half, we've been kind of locked up. We've been kind of down, depressed. We've been kind of not looking forward to days after days. And I believe it's because we didn't have the fellowship of the saints of the living God. Now God has said, as Jesus said, at the grave of Lazarus, loose them and let them free. Let us be free. Amen. Truly, we are free. We are free to worship and praise Almighty God together. It's something about being in the presence of God's people. It's something about, it's uplifting to all of us. Now, at this time, I'd like you to stand if you can, and wave to somebody near you to tell them welcome, to tell them you love them. If you can't stand, just sit. Wave your arms to somebody, because that's an encouragement to them.
Amen.
That's an encouragement to know that we're in the presence of the Lord and that we're in your presence one more time. A year from yesterday, we were in a state of depression because of the terrorist movement. Down through these last year, we've been under the impression of the depression of this coronavirus, but we're still here. We are still here. And God left us here for a reason, and that is to praise and worship his holy name together. So thank God for your presence today. Thank God for being here. It's something uplifting to our souls when we meet together. It helps us during the week, because we hear so much negative news on the media.
Amen.
So much negativeness from people we meet. But when we come together, the Word of God tells us, don't forsake the coming together of the saints, so that we may edify and glorify each other and give God praise. Thank you.
Amen. Congregation, can y'all give a one loud yell for the choir coming on back today? Amen. Amen.
Amen, amen. So we gonna do some good old-fashioned church. Not church, church. Amen. I'm a soldier on the battlefield, and I'm fighting
for the Lord.
I promised him I would serve him until I die, 'cause I'm fighting, yes I am,
fighting for the Lord.
On this Christian journey I've had heartaches and pain, sunshine and rain, but I'm fighting
for the Lord.
You know what? Said I've been up and I've been down, but I never turned around, because I'm fighting, yes I am,
fighting for the Lord.
Oh, if I hold out, hold out,
hold out, hold out,
then I know
I'll get my crown.
Yeah, I'm a soldier on the battlefield, and I'm fighting. You know what I did? I promised him I would serve him until I die, 'cause I'm fighting, yes I am, on this Christian journey. I've had heartache and pain, sunshine and rain, but I'm fighting. I've been up and I've been down, but I never turned around, because I'm fighting. Oh, if I hold out, hold out, help me sing it, y'all. I got to hold out. Help me sing it, y'all. I got to hold out. Then I know
I'll get my crown.
All right, how many soldiers we got out? We need some soldiers on the battlefield. If you a soldier, we need to stand up, 'cause we ready to fight, and let the devil know we ain't come to play. Sometimes the way is rough,
I'm on the battlefield fighting for the Lord.
But I ain't giving up.
I'm on the battlefield fighting for the Lord.
I said I'm fighting.
I'm on the battlefield fighting for the Lord.
I'm on the battlefield.
I'm on the battlefield fighting for the Lord.
I said I'm fighting.
I'm on the battlefield fighting for the Lord.
I ain't giving up. Yes, I am.
Good morning, everyone. The announcements for today, Sunday, September 12th. All CFL members and friends, please join us for service inside the sanctuary. We miss you. We ask everyone who attends to adhere to CDC guidelines to protect the safety of all who attend. Temperature checks, masks, and social distancing is required. Condolences. Sister Vivian Randolph lost her brother, James Roberts. Services will be at Morgan Funerals and Cremations, 320 South Glendale Drive, Rocky Mount, North Carolina, 27801 on Saturday, September 11. Family hour at 10 a.m. and service starts at 11. Also, Sister Angela Brooks lost her father, D.K. Cooley. Arrangements are services on Friday, September 17th at 11 at Pilgrim Bound Baptist Church, 921 Baylor's Pecan, Mississippi, 39466. Arrangements entrusted to Baylor's Funeral Home, 300 Baylor Avenue, Pecan, Mississippi, 39466. 601-798-3371. Also, Sister Desiree Vance lost her uncle. Please keep all the families in your thoughts and prayers. Church van ballots. The congregation is reminded to please turn in your ballots regarding the purchase of the church van. This decision was based upon several breakdowns of the church bus. In completing the ballots, please be mindful of members who have no transportation other than what the church provides. Ballots should be in by the end of September. Membership information. If you have not obtained a servant keeper profile data form, please get one from the church office as our database needs to be updated. If you've had changes, you can text the information to 248-802-7700. The Metropolitan Missionary Baptist District Association, MEDCC, Congress of Christian Education, annual session theme, as we seek God, walking in righteousness and growing up. Amen. Study with us in the fall of 2021 as we discover ways to become more like Christ. Register at www.metropolitanbaptistdistrict.org/Congress of Christian Education. All class sessions are via Zoom. On Saturday, October 9th, the MIU Men's Health Foundation will be hosting the 11th annual Men's Health event at Ford Field in Detroit from 9 to 3 p.m. This is a free event. This event provides info to men on how to stay healthy, free flu, COVID, and Hep A vaccines, free haircuts, raffle drives, and giveaways, fitness activities, and more. Any questions, please contact Nancy Draper at ndraper@jrturnbull.com or call 313-333-3284. You can also find info and registration at themenshealthevent.com. Youth church is now open every Sunday. Please bring your children, ages 7 to 18, to church to participate. We will meet on Sunday mornings at 10:30 a.m. Starting in September, we will only meet every first and fourth Sunday. Youth will work in the sanctuary second, third, and fifth Sundays. The youth board will resume ushering in September. The first time they will usher will be Sunday, September 19th, third Sunday at 10:30 a.m. Anyone interested in joining the youth usher board, please contact Sister Donna Young. The junior choir will rehearse on Thursdays at 6:30 p.m. Youth between 5 and 18 years of age are invited and encouraged to join. Come lift your voice and sing. CFL is continuing as a COVID-19 vaccination and testing site through September and possibly through the end of the year. Everyone is encouraged to get the shot. The following Sunday dates for September are September 12th, 19th, and the 26th, all from 10 to 2. They are also testing right now if you like to be tested or vaccinated in the fellowship hall. Part-time custodian needed at Christian Fellowship of Love Baptist Church must have janitorial skills, as job entails general maintenance, open and closing of the building, monitoring of the building to ensure proper working order, ability to strip, polish, and buff the floors. Work hours will be variable based upon church needs. Salary negotiable based upon experience. Interested, send your resume to 22400 Grand River, Detroit, Michigan 48219, or email to info@christianfellowshiplbc.org, or fax it to 313-533-2190. Send to the attention of Trustee Jackie Williams or Trustee Mildred Smith Roberts. For those who continue to send in your tithes and offerings faithfully, thank you. Also, since the church is now open, you can bring in your tithes and offering. For those who haven't or may have fallen off, please remember your church needs your tithes and offerings. All tithes and offerings should be mailed directly to the church, P.O. Box 231099, Detroit, Michigan 48223. You may drop your tithes off to church on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursdays between 10 and 2 p.m. Additionally, you may give through Givelify. Have a thank you card. Dear Pastor, how lucky I am to be a part of the Christian Fellowship of Love family. Your thoughtfulness and prayers during the loss of my brother will hold a special place in my heart forever. Love, BJ Mosley and family. Thank you for your continued support.
Good morning, Christian Fellowship of Love. What a great day to be alive. God is good. Not sometime, but all the time. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Let us stand. God has been so good to each and every one of us. He brought us a long way. And he's been faithful from one generation to another. That is why we serve him, because he's so faithful. Just look back from your youth up and just see how far he has brought you. And we have so much to be thankful for. Living in a world that's full of destruction on the left hand and on the right, what a great feeling it is to know that we have a Savior that will be with us and stand with us. He will never leave us alone. So let us pray in our heart, the ones in the building, the one outside. Heavenly Father, we just thank you one more time for such a great blessing in this dangerous time. You have kept us, and you have strengthened us. We pray, Heavenly Father, that you will continue to look after each and every one of us, the ones here and the one out in the radio land, TV land. Keep us now and guide us. We thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, that came down and died and made it possible for us to say, Our Father, which are in heaven. If we ever needed a God, we sure need him now. We're praying for the nurses and the doctors and the medical world that is working so feverishly, trying to head off this virus. Be with them, Heavenly Father. We're praying for the one that's been stricken with the virus in the hospitals in the city, the state, nation, and the world. And we also praying for the doctors and the nurses that tend to them. Be with them, Heavenly Father. and keep them. There is the family that'll be losing loved ones today. Then there's families somewhere in the world that'll be burying them. Be with them, strengthen them, let them know that this is not the end. Yes. Keep us, Father. We're praying for our pastors and the deacons and the choir members all over the world that still, in spite of the danger, still brave out and carry the word forward. Keep us now and guide us. All of this we ask in your Son Jesus' name. Let us all say amen.
Amen. Hey, Christian Fellowship, didn't the choir sound so good on that first selection? Amen. Give thanks. Oh,
thanks. Oh, thanks. Oh, give thanks. Give thanks.
Give thanks. Give thanks.
Hallelujah. Oh, give thanks. I got a question this morning. Is there anybody got a reason to tell the Lord thank you? I know we have many cliches in the church. That it woke me up this morning. Started me on my way. When you got good health, that ain't nothing but a cliche to you. But boy, let yourself wind up in a situation where you don't know if you're gonna get up. Wind up in the hospital. Don't know if you're gonna get out. And like David said, I was glad when the Lord said unto me, let me go into the house of the Lord. And then when you say, oh, give thanks, after being able to walk again, it means something, doesn't it? Oh, give thanks. When you worked hard and tried to raise your children right, and they wind up running with the wrong crew, and you get a phone call 3 o'clock in the morning saying, Daddy, I'm in jail. And all the rest of them go to jail. But you prayed, and for whatever the reason, the Lord gave your child a break. You start to find a reason to say, oh, give thanks. I think it was this past Sunday or the Sunday before when the Lord had me minister, his mercies are new. Every morning. The longer I live, the more when I wake up in the morning, I find more reasons to say thank you. Before we get into the Word of God, I just want to remind some of you that may not know it, that in the fellowship hall, the military is in there, and anybody who has not, yes, Lord, I hear you, have not had a vaccination, you can go in there today and you can get a vaccination, and you can also get tested. You know, I try not to be complicated when it comes to the Word of God, because I've learned that God is really easy to follow. When you first start reading the Word of God, it can seem a little bit complicated. But when you see the Word alive in your life, then you realize that God ain't hard to understand. And I know that those of you that may be streaming with us this morning, or maybe you in here this morning, and maybe you have not had a vaccination, and maybe you don't trust the doctors or whatever. But if you read the Word of God, way back in the Old Testament, he had doctors. And he didn't always do the healing. He would tell us sometime to go see the doctor. Matter of fact, we're getting ready to come out of Luke today, and whether you realize it or not, Luke was a doctor. And whether some of you may not realize it or not, Jesus is also considered a doctor. He is the great physician. And so sometimes God won't heal us. He'll send us to a man for a man to heal us, because God gave him the knowledge to learn how to create something that can heal us. And though they may not know everything, what they don't know, God does. And some things we're just going to have to take by faith. And I say that because when I look on the news every day, and when it first started out, all of us that are sitting in here, we were terrified, those of us who were over 65. Because we were the only ones, that age group, that was leaving here. Now here y'all sitting in here. Because by faith, you went and took the shot. Now, the young folk, sad to say, who haven't, now they're the ones that are leaving here. And so I don't know what to say to those of you that are streaming with us or who in here this morning. The only thing I can tell you is just trust God. He ain't failed you yet, has he? If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Luke, the 22nd chapter, and we want to look at just verses 31 through 34. Oh, Lord. I believe it was the Bereans that said, is there not a word from the Lord? They wanted to see Jesus to see what he had to say. And here I stand before you today, Lord, asking you the same thing. Is there not one from you and not from Terry? So, Lord, if you don't mind, please help me now. Help me to find my way through that which you've given me to say, and use me, God, so that you can get the glory out of the people that you died and me, your servant, to make your very own. Oh, God, I ask you now to bind up the lies of the enemy, bind up the distractions that he'll bring forth so that your people can hear you clearly this morning. I thank you for it now. In Jesus' name, amen. In Luke, the 22nd chapter, starting at the 31st verse and concluding at the 34th, you will find these words. And the Lord said, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan has desired to have you, that he may sift you as wheat. But I prayed for you that your faith fail not, and when thou art converted, strengthen your brethren. And he said unto him, Lord, I'm ready to go with thee both into prison and to death. Verse 34, and this is what Jesus said. He said, Peter, the cock shall crow this day before you shall thrice deny that you've known me. Amen. You may be seated. Peter, the cock's going to crow three times before you deny me. Today, we need to examine what to do when your faith is under attack. Peter's faith here was under attack. And I don't think that there's too many of us that when we're confident in ourselves, we've used the word never, only to find out that we were lying. What do you do when you're going through a testing of faith, when God seems so distant that you even have doubts about you and your faith? And I found out that it seems like when we were really confident in ourselves and we fall flat on our face, it's at those times that God doesn't seem to be nowhere near. I ain't talking to nobody this morning. Those times when even praying is hard. You know, there's times when you can pray and it can flow like a faucet that's not clogged up. But there's some times when you going through something and it just seems like you can't get a prayer through. And if you real about it, and I know we struggle as Christians that we won't be honest about some things. But in your private closet, if you real about it, you say to yourself, Lord, do you hear me? Then you start to, and don't let it, let a good bit of time transpire. And then we start to say, Lord, are you going to do something about this situation? And let some more time lapse, and after a while you may find yourself saying, well, Lord, I guess you ain't gonna do nothing about this. Y'all ain't with me this morning. This is right before Christ is about to go on the cross and die for us, that he talked to Peter about his faith coming under attack. And I want you to kind of remember who this Peter is. This is important. He's been walking with Jesus and seen Jesus do the miraculous. And so he's full of confidence because he knows that Christ can do anything. He knows that the Lord has all power to change any and every situation. And here the Lord is trying to tell them, they're in the upper room, just so you know. This is John, the 13th chapter, where they're sitting in the upper room. And the Lord is trying to tell them that some things is getting ready to happen. He's trying to tell them that I'm about to leave here. And because of all the miraculous things that the Lord has done, they just don't believe that the Lord is going to die. And so he's telling people, Peter, look, man, you need to hear what I'm telling you. You're so caught up in you that you can't hear what I'm trying to. Y'all ain't heard me yet. If the apostle Peter, who was one of the greatest people that the Lord used, faith can come under attack, then don't you feel bad because you've been saved 90 years that you struggling in your faith. Are you hearing me this morning? Can I tell you one more time what the Lord said to Peter? He said, Peter, Satan desires to have you and to sift you as wheat. But I've prayed for you so that your faith fail not. And when you converted, strengthen your brother. These words from the Lord can help you today when your faith is under attack. The first thing that they teach you when your faith is under attack is to trust in the Lord more than in your emotions. I said something right there. The emotions that God gives us, they're important, but they're never supposed to have the final say so in how you live your life. Your faith in God should always precede your feelings. Can I say that one more time? If you're struggling with your faith this morning, what you have to talk to yourself and tell yourself is, my faith is more important than my feelings. I'm an ex-gambler. And boy, let me tell you, there were many mornings that I went home broke because I felt I had a feeling. Y'all ain't never there. I know y'all good. I'm gonna talk about me. I had a feeling that I was gonna throw a head crack and I wind up throwing an ace. I'm from New York, that's CeeLo, 456, you know, that's a head crack. And if you throw two numbers with a one, that's an ace, and you automatically lose. So there was many times that I trusted my feelings only to find out that my feelings made me a fool. So I'm talking to you this morning, those of us who are born again, baptized, blood-washed believers, you ought not trust your feelings, but trust your faith in the Lord. There's nothing wrong with having or showing the right kind of emotions. You just have to work at not letting Satan use your emotions against you. You have to build yourself up with many spiritual weapons, such as being back in the house of God. That's why the Lord tells us in Hebrews that we're supposed to come to church. Because, see, when you're home by yourself, you can look at it on TV all you want to, but you can't see your brother or sister across the aisle. And when we come in the church and we see one another, we encourage each other on the battlefield of the Lord. We can look at one another sometime and see the thing and pull one up. Don't worry. The Lord gone. You can't trust your emotions. You have to build up your spiritual faith by being in church and worshiping and praying. And more than anything, you know what I've learned? When I first came into church, I was living on my emotions. I was so happy that God would save a wretch like me, I didn't know what to do. But you know what I found out after a couple of years, Sister Diane? My emotions couldn't keep me. I ain't said nothing, did I? Found out that my emotions wasn't strong enough to help me during periods and times of temptation. I found out that my emotions wasn't strong enough to help me when my faith was struggling. You know what I learned as a Christian? That a Christian is a thinking person. It has nothing to do with feeling. If the word said it, I believe it, and I'm going to follow it. That's how this thing works. Teach this morning, Pastor. Anytime your emotions don't follow faith, don't follow your emotions. A lot of negative emotions can swell up inside you. And when your faith is attacked, oh, here, I'm coming to your door, then fear and anger and worry and anxiety and doubt and all of these things are going to follow. But one of the toughest emotions you'll face when your faith comes under attack is loneliness. I know I just said something there. Yeah, when you by yourself and you're going through something, that's when the devil is at his hardest. That's when he works his best on you. When you all by, can I ask you a question? The pandemic and you were home by yourself, what kind of thoughts were you thinking? Feel like nobody cares, not even God. Which is truly ridiculous because nobody cares about you more than God. If he cared, you say to yourself, he wouldn't let this happen to me. It's funny how when things are good, we know the Lord let this happen to us. But why is it, yeah? Why is it that when things go awry in our life, we question why would God let this happen to us? Therefore, we see the wisdom of Job with his wife. Shall we only enjoy the good and not the bad? Isn't he the same God when times are good and when times are bad? That's why you can't trust your emotion, because when times are good, you know it's God. But when times are bad, it can't be nobody but the devil. And when times are bad, we doubt and we're, well, God, why are you letting me go through this? You didn't question him when he was letting you go through the good. Why do we question him when bad comes? We got to have the same faith for the good. The emotions can really play games on you. There's a spider called, it's a Portia spider. And it is really a shrewd little creature. What it'll do is it'll lay there and it'll look like a thief or something, or a leaf rather. And so when an insect happen to come by to try to bite the leaf, he finds out that it ain't nothing but the Portia spider, and it becomes dinner. Another thing that the Portia spider does that I like, it will go on another spider's web. And it'll attach itself to the web, and it'll pluck it like a guitar. So what happens is that the spider who made the web comes along and think that he caught dinner, but what happens is it becomes dinner. And what I'm trying to tell you is that's why you can't trust your emotions, because that's how the devil does us. He'll start to pluck our heartstrings and make us think that things ain't gonna turn out all right. He'll start to pluck our heartstrings and make us feel like it's over. We ain't gonna never get up out of this. God is done with us. I've messed up so bad this time. And you start to believe the lie instead of believing the one who is the truth and the life. You got to be careful with your feeling. Oh, I hear the Lord.
Some of you wouldn't be married now if you wouldn't have trusted, if you would have stopped trusting them feelings. Some of you wouldn't have been with some of them folk that you spent. Y'all, I'm sorry. Don't trust your feeling. One of my favorite ministries is premarital counseling. I love it because I believe in marriage. It symbolizes the relationship what the Lord has with the church. And I've had people leave out my office, not just here, and not get married. And I told them they did the right thing. Because if we live according to what the word says, just like we're not supposed to trust in our feelings, he said that we're not supposed to be unequally yoked. And because somebody look good, because they make you feel good, don't mean they the good thing for you. Amen. Okay, that's a sidebar. Amen, amen. So, we have to remember that we cannot trust our feelings. Psalms 37 and 23 says that the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in his way. The end of the verse says that God delighteth in your way. The Bible says that God delights in the details of your life. He gets pleasure out of knowing every little thing that goes on in your life. I'm reminded of, what was her name? Anne Morrow Lindenberg, yeah. And her dad was named David Morrow. And some years ago, he had invited Calvin Coolidge to dinner, who would eventually become the 30th president of the United States. After Calvin Coolidge left, David Morrow said, "I think he'll be a good president." The other guests that were there, they said, "No, he doesn't have any personality. He's too cold and he's too quiet." So Anne Morrow, who was 6 years old at the time, she spoke up and said, "I don't agree." She said, "I like him." And she stuck her little finger up that had a Band-Aid on it, and she said, "Out of all y'all here, he was the only one that asked me what was wrong with my finger." She said, "I know he cares. That's why he'll make a good president." Can I talk to y'all for a minute that may be struggling with your faith and going through some hard times right now? The Bible says that he knows every hair on your head. If God is so concerned about the details of hundreds of thousands of strings of hair on your head, then don't you know he knows what you're going through and are concerned about every struggle that you have? He knows this attack that you're going through is hard. He knows every mistake that you're going to make. And whatever you do, because you're going through something and you're hurting, don't make the mistake of thinking that he's not hurting right along with you, because he is. He's the same one that stood on the hill overlooking Jerusalem with tears in his eyes and said, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how I've desired to hug you like a mother hen." So you may be saying to yourself, probably like Peter, "Well, why doesn't he do something about what I'm going through? Why is he allowing me to go through this? Doesn't he see how I'm hurting?" Well, the answer to the question is, you need to trust in the Lord's character building process. God, he doesn't enjoy really seeing you go what you're going through right now. He really, really doesn't. But he does long to see your character be more like Jesus. Can I say that one more time? I don't know, and I'm probably gonna get in trouble by saying this, but we've been being taught the wrong thing for so long. And we've been teaching y'all the wrong thing for so long, so that you'll come to church with your money and feel good, leaving church still living like a sinner. Amen.
We can't pack the church if we don't make you shout. We can't get the money to live in our mansions and fly airplanes if we don't make you feel good still being like you are. But that's not God. He didn't die for you and me to deliver us from sin, to deliver us from the fire that waits a sinner, for us to continue. Christ's comparison assignment's test to a farmer sifting wheat, it really points to the positive outcome of suffering. Woo! See, that's why you're going through what you're going through. That's where your focus needs to be when your faith comes under attack. One of the things that happens when your faith comes under attack is it gives you an opportunity to grow. Can I say that one more time? One of the primary things that happens when your faith is under attack is it gives you an opportunity to grow. I believe it was Reverend Henry Weinberger, I believe his name. He was the president of Bethel College and Seminary in St. Paul, Minnesota. And this is what he said. He said, a Christian's personality is hidden on the inside, and you really don't know what's in there. He said, the only way you'll know, it's like a waiter at a restaurant who has a bowl of soup on a high tray, and he's walking by. You really don't know what's in the bowl until somebody bumps into him, and what's on the inside spills out on the outside. Can I talk for a minute? Me and Deacon Brown and Deacon Addison, we was in the room over here painting yesterday. And we were talking about church. As a pastor and a deacon, what else we gonna talk about? And we were talking about church and how, as Christians, we need to grow. And I shared with them a story. My Aunt Millie, bless her soul, she said, Terry, I'm her nephew, she can call me what she want. She said, Terry, church folk will make me put down my religion in a minute. And I said, the reason is that you could do it on Millie because it wasn't heavy in the first place. And so what you don't understand, the reason that God will allow us to go through what we go through is because you really don't know you like you think you do until somebody bumped you and what's on the inside of you. Because if Christ is living on the inside of you, the fruit of the Spirit gonna come out of you. When somebody try you, you'll say, it's all right. I love you anyhow. I'm praying for you anyhow. If you need me, call me. But if Christ ain't on the inside of you thriving, what's gonna come out of you? If you try me one more, if you bump me, I'm gonna knock you. You listen here. Let me tell you about 13 curses that I know real good. Blip, blop, blip, blop, dot, dot. Christ, let your faith be tried to show you who you are. Yes, Lord. There's a difference between being saved and being a Christian. Because when you're a Christian and you try, the fruit of the Spirit will come out. But when you're saved and you try, carnality will come out. And so what the Lord has to do is he has to continually let our faith be tried so that in hopes one day we'll look at ourselves and see who we really are. Amen. In the eyes of Christ. Y'all ain't with me this morning. I knew y'all wasn't gonna shout. That's okay. But I want you to understand that the Lord has even more positive results in mind when he allows you to come under attack by teaching you to trust in his plan. By you trusting in the Lord's plan, then you will take your focus off yourself. Amen. when your faith is being attacked. That's why Jesus, and that's what Jesus taught us to do by his words to Peter when he said, don't miss this. When thou art converted, strengthen your brethren. Notice what he tells him. Can we learn this today, please? He says, Peter, Satan desires to have you and to sift you as wheat. He says, but I'm not going to get involved in what I'm going to let him do to you. But I'm going to pray for you. Lord, I hear you. So that when you're converted, you go strengthen your brethren. Can we be real in the church this morning? How many of us come to church really for what we want the Lord to do for us? How many really come to church for one reason? Lord, I need you. I'm going through some stuff. And I need you to do some stuff for me. Can I teach this morning? The test that Simon Peter was going through, it wasn't about him. It was also about what he had to learn so he could help somebody else. See, the test of your faith that you're going through, it really ain't about you. That's what's wrong with the church today. All of our focus is on ourselves. The world is dying. There's so many people out there really just waiting for you to tell them about Jesus. So many people. But we get in our cars that the Lord has blessed us with. Can I talk free this morning? We come to church complaining about the church because it may not be what you want it to be. We go home to our house, big houses, big TVs, big couches, house enough for 30 people to live in, got enough groceries that we can survive through 8 pandemics, got enough clothes that if we would take them all to Goodwill tomorrow, they couldn't take them all in. That's what's wrong with us. I'm not saying you. I'm saying the church in the United States. That's what's wrong with the church. It's scared to even talk to somebody that need to hear Jesus. We'll ride by somebody because they look like they might rob us. I mean, that's wisdom. But how many of them you gonna ride by? Somebody cared about you 40, 50 years ago. That's when the church was different. Somebody, when you were a thug, a gangster, a hootie, a hottie, somebody wasn't afraid to tell you, you need Jesus. What's the whole point of this passage? It was to teach Peter and us that it really is not about us. And what he had to do was he had to put Peter through the painful character-breaking process to show him that it wasn't about him. It's a sad student that keep getting left back in the same class before he realizes that it's not the teacher's fault, but it's his. You cannot say your faith has grown. You cannot say your character has changed until your heart is concerned about other people. Look what he said to Peter. He says, Peter, when you're converted, strengthen. Yes, Lord, I hear you. How many of us, when we were down and out, didn't know how we were going to make it? Maybe you might have been on death's bed and you told the Lord, Lord, if you just get me out of this, I'll serve you. I'll tell everybody about you. And then you got on your feet and you forgot everything you told the Lord. And what'd he do? He got a hold of you again. And then you saying, I wonder, what have I, what, Lord, why? He says, Peter, when you get it together, help others. What we must not miss is the fact what was happening prior to this. Please, 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 when you get home, go read a few verses prior to this, and you know what you're gonna find? That the disciples, they were arguing among themselves. They were saying, who gonna be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? James, John, and Peter. They were, the Lord used me more than anybody. I know I'm gonna have the best seat in heaven. They're arguing about who was gonna be the best, and Jesus about to die. They're more concerned about position than the fact that their master is about to be crucified. And so he stops them. He said, wait a minute. He says, hold on a minute. He said, y'all talking about heaven and your seat there. He says, before this night is over, you will deny me. What I need to bring to your attention, that word you is not singular. It is plural. So he really wasn't just talking to Peter. He was telling all of them. They had gotten so selfish because Jesus had been so good to them. They was worrying about the next blessing and not Jesus himself. Yeah. So he says to them, wait a minute. I got to teach y'all something. I'm not talking to y'all. I'm talking what the word said. This is a humbling lesson for all of us. That even being saved, we can still go in the wrong direction. We can still miss the mark. And like them, we can have the wrong agenda. That's where Peter and disciples missed it. They were arguing about going to heaven. And like them, that's where so many of us miss it. We have our own agenda that is completely contrary to the agenda that God has for us. So he looks at Peter and he tells Peter specifically what he was going to do. And he tells him he's about to go through a period of humiliation, a period of brokenness, a period of character adjustment. And that's my way, Jesus is saying, I'm doing this so I can turn you around. Yes. Doing this, Peter, because it's not about you. I need to fix the way you're thinking. Amen. So you can help some other folk. Yeah. And what I need you to understand is when he says help others, y'all please don't miss this. He's not telling Peter to start a food drive, although that's needed. When he tells Peter, when you're converted, help your brethren, he's not telling Peter to build affordable housing. That's needed. Yeah. He's not telling Peter to start a clothes drive. That's needed. Yeah. But what he says is, when I turn your life around, I need you to go help somebody else. That word strengthening here, when he said, thou art converted, strengthen thy brethren, I'm get out your way. That word literally means to make a person's mind firm. Yeah. It literally means to correct the way that somebody is thinking. And what he's telling Peter, he said, more important than food, more important than shelter, more important than clothing. Peter, when you change the way you thinking, I need you to help other folk change the way that they're thinking. I'm reminded, and I am, let me just talk and I'm all right. I'm reminded of a drunk named Joe. He used to go down to the mission all the time. And one night, miraculously, he gave his life to the Lord. And he was converted. People thought that Joe would always be nothing but a drunk and a wino. But he gave his life to the Lord. And he was converted. So much so that he became the most caring and loving person that worked at the mission. He would go to the mission and clean the floors and sweep. And when the other drunks would come in and throw up, he had no problem going into the restroom and cleaning it up. He would serve food, anything that somebody needed to be done. Joe didn't have a problem with it. One night, the minister was giving an evangelistic message, and Near the end of the service, one of the drunks came running down the aisle shouting, "I want to be like Joe. I want to be like Joe. I want to be like Joe." So the preacher leaned over and said, "Don't you mean you want to be like Jesus?" The drunk said, "Is Jesus like Joe?" And the preacher said, "Jesus is the one that changed Joe." And the Lord just wanted me, as we're getting ready to get back in church, and as he continues to keep his good hand on you, and maybe you're going through something today that maybe the Lord trying to tell you, it's time for you to grow up and act like Jesus. Amen. Stop thinking about you, because it's a whole lot of people out there that are waiting to see you act like Jesus. Yes, sir. So that they themselves can want Jesus. Amen.
And amen. What a powerful word that the Lord has rendered unto us today. I know the Lord was speaking to someone, because I know for sure he was speaking to me. It's good when you wake up in the morning and you're on your way to church and you ask the Lord to give you a word, something that will carry you through the week, something that you're going through, or something that needs to happen in your life. And when you hear that word, it feels so good and so great that you make your spirit to shout for joy. Yeah. The doors of the church are open. God is waiting and calling on you today. Whatever you are going through, trust the Lord and not your feelings, your emotions. Focus on God and his faithfulness. Believe in each and every word that is in the word, that is life, that will give you life. When you come today, God is waiting on you. You can come candidate for baptism, or you can come by reinstatement. God is waiting on you. He spoke to you directly today. He spoke to your hearts. He spoke to your mind. He opened up your ears so that you can hear, and made it simple so that you would be able to understand. When you come today, clap of praise for the powerful word that he did render on us today. And let's be also be mindful when we're going through this week, that if we're going through something, just watch the sermon again and listen to it. What you missed, you can always rewind it and go back and listen to it again. This message was for you today. It was for you. Trust the Lord and not your emotions. Jesus prayed for us all. Amen.
Just as a reminder, we're going to receive our benediction and we're going to take up our tithes and offerings, and we'll dismiss after that. But I just want to remind everyone that in the fellowship hall, if you're considering vaccinations, you can get it now. They'll be here every Sunday. And you can also get a COVID test. Now to him was able to present us faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, hence both now and forever. Father God, I lift your people up before you now, asking you to continue, O God, to be merciful as only you can and gracious unto them whom you died to make them your very own. I pray, God, that you'll go before them so that they can travel to and fro safely back to the homes that you provided. I thank you that your word will not return back to you void. And, O God, when they get home, let peace be waiting for them. We thank you for it now. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us follow the instructions of the ushers. Oh. Father God, we thank you now for the offerings that we're about to receive. Bless the giver, God. And we thank you for cheerful givers, Lord. And we pray, God, that you'll restore it back to them, pressed down and running over. In Jesus' name, amen. There's going to be a brief meeting for the women's ministry. Right after church, there is a brief meeting for the women's ministry right after church. So good to see some of you I haven't seen in a while. We thank you for the guests who have come in fellowship with us today. We pray that the Lord had said something just for you. There won't be any youth church rehearsal this week. Junior choir. There won't be any junior choir rehearsal this week. So good to see Sister Wade back. Amen. Sister BJ back.